To start today's class, what I want to do is go through second take-home exam one problem from 2 years ago's class, which is a new type of problem involving a new type of idea that's hinted at by this star symbol right there. It's called a convolution operator. Being a new idea, and being this is the last class before your exam one, if I put this on your exam one, it would probably be on the take home, in addition to perhaps a simulation problem or two on the take home. It's a hard enough idea as well. But once again, in this class, being an applied class, I mean, we're talking about theoretical ideas, though we ultimately want to look at applications, but we don't want to make it too theoretical because that would just get too hard and sort of beyond the point of the class. So we'll illustrate theory, talk about theory sort of more in the context of examples than giving a full blown theoretical treatment of things. So we're example based. And this does have important applications in real life. What we're after here are looking at the sum of two random variables. W is X plus Y. And it's also related to chapter 7. And we're going to relate this to the material in the last couple sections of chapter 7, in particular, the fingerprint theorem, the fact about moment generating functions of sums of random variables, and the central limit theorem. Try to, after going through this problem, relate this to those. Actually, I want to do one more problem beyond this as well that's related to convolution. Well, let's go ahead and get into this. Let X and Y be independent discrete random variables with the following now I call this PMFs. I'm trying to emphasize that with discrete, even though our book still calls them PDFs because it's an old book, it's more traditional these days to call them PMFs, probability mass functions, because these values of these functions give actual probabilities. You don't have to integrate them to find probabilities. They're not giving you probability densities. So they're independent, and W, yes, is the sum of these two variables that are assumed to be independent. That independence assumption is necessary to make the problem easier. If they're not independent, then the problem can become much harder. We want to find the PMF of this random variable W that is the sum of X and Y. And remember, with PMFs, probability mass functions, yes, like I just said a minute ago, you plug in numbers into them to find actual probabilities. Their outputs, their values give you actual probabilities instead of probability densities, right? That's nice with discrete random variables. You don't have to integrate. And this convolution operator thing is just a symbol, okay? It's just a symbol for a way to combine the two PMFs for X and Y, called F and G, to get the PMF for W, the sum of X and Y. I'm calling that PMF H. Okay, so it's like an addition multiplication symbol, function composition. It's a binary operation. Hey, algebraic structure, abstract algebra people, binary operation, a way to combine two functions to get another function in this case. So it's just a symbol. How do you actually find it? Let's just take it case by case. This is discrete with finite set where these PMFs are positive, so I can just go ahead and compute some values, essentially fill in a table for the random variable W. What is H of 0? That's the probability that capital W equals 0. Capital W is X plus Y. And in this context, since X and Y can't take on negative values, they're non-negative random variables. They can't take on negative values because there's the probability that they take on a negative value is zero. The only way this can happen is if X and Y are both zero. And there we have the lovely word and in there, which alerts us to using, by the assumption of independence, the multiplication rule. This is the same as the probability that X equals zero times the probability that Y equals zero. Now just look in the table. probability that x equals zero is the 0.5 right there, 0.5. The probability that y equals zero is the 0.65. Multiply those, you'll get 0.325. Right? Check my arithmetic. Yes, 0.325. So there is the probability that w equals zero. That's the value of the PMF h at w equals zero. How about h of one? Probability that w equals one, which means the probability that x plus y equals one. Based on the nature of where x and y can take on values with positive probability, this can happen in one of two ways. You can think of it as a compound event. X equals one and y equals zero, or x equals zero and y equals one. These two events, x equals one and y equals zero versus x equals zero and y equals one, are definitely mutually exclusive events, right? Disjoint. If one happens, the other can't happen. You don't need to assume they're mutually exclusive. They are mutually exclusive. So by the or there and the addition rule, which is really an axiom for probability, I can say this is the sum of the probability that x equals one and y equals zero with the probability that x equals zero and y equals one. And there I have, and again, that's the same by the multiplication rule for independent events. I'm assuming independence, remember? I didn't make that assumption. That's why it would get a lot harder. I'd have to think about conditional probability. I'd have to know some conditional probabilities. Maybe based on some given joint distribution even. I can multiply these probabilities. I didn't write in the first line here these things in terms of f and g, but I could have. This was the same as f of zero times g of zero up there. I can write this in terms of f and g. This is the same as f of one times g of zero plus f of zero times g of one. In terms of the PMFs, probability mass functions of x and y individually. Looking at the table, f of one is 0.3, g of zero is 0.65. It's easy to make a mistake here, including me, it's easy to make a mistake, so be careful. F of zero is 0.5, and g of one is 0.25. Don't want to make a mistake. Use my calculator here. 0.3 times 0.65, 0.195, and then 0.5 plus 0.25. I can do that in my head. It's 0.125. So this gives 0.32. So the first value, the probability that w equals 0 is 0.325. The probability that w equals 1 is 0.32. I could also try to compute the CDF of W. Capital H of zero would be 0.325 and capital H of one would be the sum of these two would be 0.645. Continue, what about little h of two? Probability that W equals two, meaning the sum of X and Y is two. Using the same kind of logic, the addition rule for disjoint mutually exclusive events and the multiplication rule, we would find that you ultimately get f of two times g of zero plus f of one times g of one plus f of zero times g of two. Why? Because f of two means x equals two. With g of zero, we're referring to the probability that y equals zero. One way x plus y can equal two is if x is two and y is zero. Another way x plus y could equal two is if x is one and y is one. And a third way that x plus y could equal two is if x is zero and y is two. So I skipped some steps there. I should have colored that green. Anyway, go back up to the table, be really careful. F of 2 is 0.2 times g of 0 is 0.65. 0.2 times 0.65. F of 1 is 0.3, g of 1 is 0.25. F of 0, I didn't make a mistake today. You got to be super careful with not making mistakes here. F of 0 is 0.5, and g of 2 is 0.1. Does it look good? This gives 0.13 plus 0.075 plus 0.05, if I've not made a mistake. Okay. That's the probability that the sum of the two variables is 2. H of 3, probability that the sum is 3. X plus y equals 3. Neither variable can equal 3 individually with positive probability. But the sum can be 3. X could be 2 and y could be 1. Or X could be 1 and Y could be 2. Leave a little space in here. Well, do dot, dot, dots. Leave a little space. Let me write F of 2 times G of 1 plus F of 1 times G of 2. Leave some space there. I'm going to finish the calculation. Now by looking at the table, but continue leaving space. F of 2. F of 2 is 0.2. G of 1 is 0.25. 0.2 times 0.25. F of 1 is 0.3 and G of 2 is 0.1. Let's also leave a little space here. What's the final answer going to be? This is going to be 0.05 plus 0.03, 0.08, it looks like. What are we up to here? 0.325 plus 0.32 is 0.645. 0.645 plus 0.255 is up to 0.9. Add on 0.08, we're up to 0.98. Getting really close to 1. There's only one more value W can take on, that's 4, when X is 2 and Y is 2. Why did I leave some space? Because I also could have written F of 3 times G of 0 plus in there. But F of 3 is 0, so it doesn't affect anything. And I also could have written plus F of 0 times G of 3. But G of 3 is 0, so it doesn't affect anything. Why did I do that? Because it fits the pattern better, hinting at the more general formula for the convolution of two non-negative random variables. Let's do the last case, H of 4. Dot, dot, dot. Let's just write it with some space in here as F of 2 times G of 2. If X is 2 and Y is 2, then the sum is 4. And F of 2 times G of 2, looking at the table, I won't bother showing you, is ultimately 0.2 times 0.1, giving us 0.02 as it had to be if this is the last value, possible value of X. Remember, we were at 0.98 for the sum of these probabilities, so this brings us up to 1. Well, we go in the space there. How about F of 4 times G of 0 plus F of 3 times G of 1. I want the inputs to add to 4 over here, plus F of 1 times G of 3 and plus F of 0 times G of 4. But those are all zeros because this is 0, this is 0, this is 0, and this is 0. So I don't have to put them in there, but it's nice to put them in there to emphasize, again, the pattern. In each case, whatever the input is for H, I add up products of F and G where the sum of the inputs for F and G have to add to that value that you're plugging into H, in this case, 4. Where the sum ranges over, focus on the inputs of G, the input of G, say, going from 0 up to whatever the number I'm plugging into H is. So it seems to be the pattern is that H of W, the convolution of F and G evaluated W, discrete convolution, there's a continuous convolution as well that maybe I will talk about next Tuesday before spring break. After going over your exam, maybe I'll talk about the continuous convolution, though I probably won't test you on it ever, but just to inform you about it. The formula seems to be add up, say as K goes from 0 up to W, F of, let's see, the input of G is going to be the K. That starts at 0 and goes up to W. If you look at the pattern here, the input of F would have to be W minus K. Although it is symmetric, we could think of the summation in the opposite order. This does equal the summation K goes from 0 to W of F of K times G of W minus K. When I think of it the first way, I'm thinking of the summation that you see here from left to right. When I think of it the second way, I'm thinking of the summation going from right to left. Essentially, it's the commutative property of addition that allows you to write it either way.